Hello and welcome to this episode of the National Arts Centre NACOcast series. My name is Sean Rice and I play clarinet with the National Arts Centre Orchestra. For this episode, we have our principal cellist, Rachel Mercer, in the Hexagon Studio to discuss her new album that she recently recorded. Welcome and thanks for joining us today, Rachel.
Thank you.
So what did we just hear?
We heard the title track from the album, and it's an album of duos for violin and cello by all Canadian women, and it was recorded by me and my sister, who's a violinist. So it's a really very personal album for me, and just the genesis of the album was wanting to play with my sister, who's a fantastic musician, and years of looking for a repertoire for that combination and finding the repertoire for duo is pretty small. And so I was always looking for Canadian music, and I played most of the ones written by men and other ones. And I found in the Canadian Music Center, duos by Violet Archer and Jean Coulthard, who were like the big composers of the 20th century, both women, huge repertoire, and they've barely been played. And I really wanted to record them, and ended up commissioning three other pieces and finding one more duo to play. So the one that you just heard was by Rebecca Cummings, who's a young composer. We had composers of different generations. She's about the same age as me, and she started to get into her roots, her Bulgarian heritage. So that's why you hear a little bit of that flavor in the piece. She called it "Our Strength, Our Song," which the idea came from knowledge passed down through generations of women in the Bulgarian traditions.
Okay.
So it has a lot of meaning, and she wrote it for us in the end of 2018, and she actually passed away a few months later from brain tumor. So, and she's very young. So,
oh my goodness,
like there's many layers of meaning in this. When I hear this music, it's everything that she represents and the bond between women through generations and sisters, and our strength, our song. What that means today, and so it's a very for us very powerful piece, and that's why we made it the title track. But
wow, I'm sorry to hear that that she passed away. The album, the inspiration for it, sounds like obviously you're looking for Canadian women composers first and foremost, is that correct?
It started with just the Archer and Coulthard, but then it's kind of ended up like that, and it actually also the music spans about 40-ish years, which is kind of around our ages and everything, so it kind of just, you know, really represents our two lives as musicians and the composers and the where it
went. So before we go into all the pieces on this program, let's talk about your sister. Where she based, and she plays violin, right?
Yeah. My sister's a violinist. She went to Germany to study at university age, and she never left. So she's been there over 15 years now.
Cool.
She studied in Cologne, and then she was in the Munich Phil Orchestra Academy for a couple years. And then won a job in the Frankfurt Radio Orchestra, where she's assistant principal, second violin.
Awesome.
So she's been there for a long time, and we've played together all of our lives since we were little. And she's just so incredible, and so a chance to get over to Canada and work together and actually see her and play with her was part of the reason of doing this project together.
So the other composers, can we talk about who else is on this album?
Yeah, so we have Violet Archer, Jean Coulthard. Those are older works. I found a work by Barbara Monk Feldman, which was written in 89 when she was in Germany. Actually, I think she was in Holland. But so this is a very different work from the others on the program. And she's, of course, is alive today. Mm-hmm. And we actually worked on the piece with her. She came to our house. And what's interesting about that, working with composers who are alive, you know, you prepare a piece, you get your interpretation from what you see on the page, and then they go, "Oh, no, I meant this." And then it's a completely different idea, which is, you know, that's what we have on the page only goes so far. So it was amazing to have her there.
Sometimes the opposite experience is like, oh, I never thought of it that way.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then the three other pieces were new commissions. So Rebecca Cummings' piece, Alice Ho, who she's written stuff for me before, and some of it has been kind of Asian influenced, and my sister and I are both half Japanese, so she actually went in that direction, and it's inspired by Music for the Gods, in the Japanese kind of theater world, old traditional world.
Cool.
And she has some really neat effects that she created from using guitar picks that sound like a koto or shamisen, the Japanese instruments. And then the last commission was Jocelyn Morlock. And I've always wanted to have her write something for me. I've played some of her music now, and I just love it, and her just special kind of sound world. And she wrote us a really fun piece called Serpentine Paths, which has many meanings. I mean, they all took the idea of sisters or, you know, a duo different ways. But yeah, it's a really fun piece to play, too.
The piece you talked about with other sounds. Yep. What other types of sounds are you employing in that piece?
Okay, so there's plucking. There's normal kind of plucking that we do, but it is supposed to sound more like a traditional instrument. So my sister does have to use a guitar pick.
Okay.
Which she actually played the koto as a kid. She took maybe 8 years of koto lessons.
Wow.
So she can really do it well. it's amazing what it sounds like. She also, Alice, she got us to take a pencil and bang the strings. So I think her idea was getting this kind of very percussive sound.
Okay.
Like, also like in theater or that old traditional Japanese music. And I think she knew that string players do not want to bang their bows on the string.
So she said pencils instead.
But yeah, so that was, it was interesting experimenting with like what kind of pencil, where on the pencil to use. You know, do not use a pencil that has paint on it because the paint chips will fly everywhere. So
different lengths, you don't really want that in your instrument.
So it was an interesting thing to learn, and she really created an amazing effect in the music with that.
Great. So, I mean, this is probably obvious for me, but not for our listeners, but you have so many projects you do outside of the orchestra. You're very busy as a chamber musician, and I'm assuming that this project also was part of that part of your career too. Like, I imagine you're touring these performances together, right?
Yeah, we're hopefully going to do more performances of this particular project, but there's so many things that interest me to do. I've got the little dream book that has all the ideas that I want to try someday, and luckily in the last 20 years, I've been in the position to commission works or find a way to create a recording. And those are, for me, it's a more tangible way of leaving something in the world.
Yeah.
You know, I love performing. That's what I live for. But, you perform and then it's gone.
Right.
Which the moment is still there. You know, it'll live inside everybody who experienced it. But having a piece written, especially selfishly for yourself, is always nice. And then creating a recording that you know, for me, when I make a recording the next day, I just can't listen to it. That's just the way it works. But it's really a moment in time. It shows that moment. Yes, of course, I play it differently now. But so I really enjoy doing that. And I've done that with various chamber groups and myself over the years.
Cool. Sorry, I'm going to go back to the recording for one second. But can we talk about the Archer and the Coulthard pieces? What are they? What kind of sounds do you hear in them before you learn them, and now that you've performed them and recorded them, what kind of things were you finding in those works?
Okay, the Archer, she taught at the University of Alberta for many years, and my mom actually studied composition with her.
Oh, really?
And she gave me a little Snoopy doll when I was like just bored.
That's awesome.
I don't have the Snoopy doll, so there's this kind of weird personal connection there. But I found these four duets which are on the program, and they're written in her very clear handwriting. I think she was this tiny little woman, apparently, with lots of character. The music is, I think, like her music. There is a influence of Hindemith, though she did study with all the great, a bunch of the great composers in Europe and North America. It really has contrasting characters. I think the first one was called Brooding, so there's this brooding cello solo, and then then kind of fast rhythmical things which show the interplay of two string players together, which for a duo, I mean, that's what lots of the composers explore, that kind of duo conversation together. The Coulthard, they both actually wrote it for the Rolston family. Shauna and Tom Rolston were violinist and cellist, father, daughter. So Jean Coulthard also wrote for them.
Okay.
And Jean Coulthard, I had played her music before, so it's this different kind of sound world. People often say it sounds English. I hear a bit of French in it, the harmonic sound world, and that kind of character. So I think this piece definitely has that. But again, it's actually a very difficult piece.
Okay.
So I think that's partly why it wasn't played a lot, but also because it is a very, it seems like she wrote it really fast because
okay.
it's in her handwriting.
And it's is it clear?
Oh, it's not legible. And also there's parts that say rewrite this bar.
Oh, great.
You know,
you're
things
like
that.
So, what do I do with that?
Yeah, so we actually had hired someone to engrave it to make us like a computerized score.
That's good.
So we could actually learn it much faster.
That makes it much easier.
Yeah, so hopefully with that and the recording, people will now be able to play it.
Yeah, well, I mean, that's so you talked a little bit about this, the hope that this music and the new works you've helped commission
right.
are going to go out there and have other lives.
Right.
Can you talk a little more about your thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, I mean, violoncello duo is a very common kind of chamber music offering, and it's something that as a cellist I've done a lot and played with lots of mm-hmm. different violinists, so there is a need out there for more music. So it is, and it is limited. So these works, I think, are adding another dimension to the repertoire, and a Canadian voice over 40
yes.
years,
yeah.
Which is very interesting to me, at least, mm-hmm. and hopefully to others.
Absolutely. And what's the process of going about and building a CD, commissioning? How much, I mean, there's a lot of work that goes into that. And for those who don't really understand that, could you speak a little bit to how the kind of work that goes in behind the scenes, not mm-hmm. just learning the music, not just hiring a composer, but there's a lot of paperwork, I imagine, as well.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I really believe in paying the musicians.
Yeah.
So the very first thing is starting to try to find funding for mm-hmm. the commissions. So it's a lot of grant writing, which I've gotten better at. I'm much faster than I was 20 years ago to write a grant. And there's that, and then there's the planning out of everything. You know, if you've got to book a producer, mm-hmm. and we had a fantastic producer with David Yeager. It was the first time I worked with him.
Cool.
And he's, of course, a composer himself and was the producer of CBC's Two New Hours for many, many years, creator and producer. So we were really lucky to have him. But just to book all those people, make sure they're on board, mm-hmm. you know, keep checking in with them.
Well, how long in advance do you have to do that?
At least 2 years.
Wow.
And yeah, the yeah. idea is coming earlier than that. And then, you know, then you know, you've got the, you have to create a contract for the composers. And that's mm-hmm. something I've learned recently. It's really like writing contracts. I can write a contract.
Yeah.
I don't know how legal it is, but I can write a contract.
It's okay. It's done,
yeah,
right?
It's done. So yeah. And then you're kind of waiting for the piece. You're mm-hmm. like, is the composer going to finish on time? And
right.
of course, some do, some don't. You know, but you allow for that. You have to, you know that that's maybe going to happen
right.
and space that out. And then there's the actual receiving of the music and being like, okay, now mm-hmm. let's see how this goes. Can I even play this?
You know, right.
And
hello, composer, this part's really not playable.
I think we did do a lot of back and forth with all of them.
Great.
We sent them recordings, and then
so there was a real collaboration during the writing process.
Yeah, but mostly the pieces were really, they're played as they are. There were tiny
great.
Little things that were adjusted. But
awesome.
Yeah.
Amazing. That's so cool. So like I mentioned earlier, you're very busy with other things. So you have a couple of projects like Made in Canada Ensemble. Can you talk about some of your chamber music stuff that you do outside of your incredibly busy role as principal cellist as well as this orchestra?
Well, I'm really lucky to have been playing chamber music all of my life. The most recent groups that I've been with are the Piano Quartet Ensemble Made in Canada. I've been, and we've toured Canada. We've toured in the States. We recently, over the last 2 years, did a big project called the Mosaic Project, which was 14 very small piano quartets, all inspired by a region of Canada. So it became this hour-long piece, which we've recorded. The CD's coming out. We toured it across Canada, every single province and territory.
Okay.
And on January 24th, we're actually doing a live stream concert of it. From St. Catharines, the First Ontario Performing Arts Centre.
I'm imagining these are all new works.
Yeah.
Yeah. So who composed these works?
Yeah, so these are by composers from across the country and in different genres too, not just classical. We have two singer-songwriters, Sarah Sleen and Julie Doiron.
Great.
Yeah, some jazz guys, Andrew Downing, David Braid, Darren Sigismund. We have Nicole Lise wrote us something, and a whole bunch of amazing classical composers, Kevin Lau, Sammy Musa, Anna Sokolovich, Vivian Fong. I mean, we were so lucky that we got
these
people.
That's the who's who in Canada.
They're incredible.
Yeah.
And the music they wrote us is incredible. And we, you know, we've played it over 50 times now, and it's still brings us something every time. So
great.
That was a very special project.
And where can we find that online?
On if you look up Ensemble Made in Canada, okay, our website, you could find out more
great
information.
Perfect. You also have this collaboration with Stuart Goodyear, right? This is a long relationship you have with him as a collaborator. Am I right in saying?
I mean, in a way, it's funny. I feel close to him, yet we barely know each other in another
really
way. We okay actually first met when we were about 13, and okay we played in a piano trio together at the conservatory.
I would say that's a healthy, long relationship as
well,
friends, wouldn't you?
Well, it depends what
happens in between. I mean, you
work together. Yeah, maybe long term. Yeah, so we played in a piano trio at the conservatory in Toronto and
cool
got coachings by Roman of the Griffin Trio. Mm-hmm. I remember that very clearly. And it was obvious that, I mean, Stuart was already playing. I think he had played here with NACO his debut with the orchestra at age 11.
Oh, wow.
And that's actually relevant
that's
to the concerto.
That's nothing at
all. Like, yeah. So, I mean, he was already that.
Yeah.
You know? So getting to play a trio with him at 13 was kind of cool.
Right, cool.
And then over the years, we've played together a couple more times. And then a few years ago, he knew I was in a piano quartet. And I think he sent me a recording of a piano quartet he'd mm-hmm just written and okay had been premiered. So my piano quartet ended up playing it at Chamberfest
okay
a few years ago. And it's a really interesting piece. I didn't know his music before. Of course, he's been writing all his life, and he's one of those that can sit on the piano and
that's amazing
improvise.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen his the Shark song, Baby Shark song.
No, I've not
that
seen
went
that
viral, but then
oh
he
goodness
wrote a fugue on Baby Shark, and I just
no
watched
he didn't
it recently.
Did he?
but it's crazy.
Hey, parents,
like,
go get
shows
that now.
So what his mind is like? It's,
yeah,
it's incredible.
Cool. He wrote a fugue on it.
Yeah,
that's amazing. That's another level. I can't even play the piano. I can only read one note at a time. I play the clarinet.
Same here.
Is he going to be here soon for your Mufasa?
Yeah, he's going to be here playing a Mufasa recital on February 2nd.
I should explain,
yeah,
that's music for a Sunday afternoon, not Mufasa from Lion King. But it's the Music for Sunday Afternoon series at the National Art Gallery. So it's February 2nd, right, in the afternoon?
Yeah,
please.
Which
continue
will include his piano quartet.
Okay.
The pianist is going to be Angela Park, who is my collaborator in my piano quartet.
Mm-hmm.
And also we've played as a duo for about 15 years. So
mm-hmm
it's someone that it's like coming home to play with her. It's
great.
Really just, we have this flow together. So it's really great to have her on the program. And Yosuke Kawasaki and Jethro Marx will be joining us for the piano quartet.
Great. What else is on that program?
Yeah. We're going to open with me and Joel Corrington playing the Rossini duo, which is
oh,
so
yeah
fun. We've done it a few times now. And it's just, I mean, I love playing with Joel. He's one of my biggest mentors and inspires me all the time. And to get to play that with him, and we did it actually in November in Parry Sound at a bunch of school concerts.
Okay.
And I mean, we already have a lot of fun with the piece, and
right
it was going over the top. But I think we're going to keep that spirit because we just, you know, egg each other on.
Well,
and it's
he's no fun at
piece
all, is he?
it's so incredible to play with him.
Awesome.
And then
cool
the second half, Angela and I are going to do the Rachmaninoff sonata.
Oh, lovely.
Rachmaninoff piano and cello sonata, since it's a piano concerto, but
yeah,
it's just beautiful.
Well, you know, Rachmaninoff,
music,
right?
Yeah.
Awesome. And there's still more to talk about with Stuart, right? Because isn't he writing a piece for you?
Yeah, so
da-da-da
he's going to be there on the date of the recital. But he also, in 2015, I got this random email I hadn't heard from him in years. Rachel, I want to write you a cello concerto.
That's fabulous.
What?
Like,
really? What? Did you make a mistake? Did you meet another Rachel? Why? But he said, yes, I want to do this. And then I didn't hear anything for years, maybe 3 years. And then after playing his piano quartet, we kind of got in touch again. And he was serious about it. He said, I'm writing. So we worked on a grant together to find funding. And then we got very happily NACO on board. And they helped find other funding to fund the concerto and set a date, which is February 14th. It's coming up. The process to get there is long, and I'm
mm-hmm
right in the middle of it right now. I wake up in the middle of the night with the themes going through my head. It's, so it's really like overloading, but
funny.
It's incredible to have
yep
someone write you a piece,
of
and
course,
especially to get to play it with this orchestra. But yeah.
Can we talk about the piece a bit? Is that okay?
Yeah.
I'm curious about the structure. Like, is it a multi-movement work? Is it please.
It's really, there's everything in here, and it's so amazing how it reflects his personality and his mind, yet also he apparently went deep into cello music and cello technique and like studied all kinds of things. So there's all kinds of, first of all, it kind of sits nicely on the cello.
That's good.
And it's more about, it seems more about like how the fingers fit on the cello sometimes than even harmony or something, if that makes sense. But he wrote parts where I get to really rock out, which
fun.
Is what every cellist wants to do. And then, you know, parts which are really vulnerable and a kind of beautiful in a kind of mysterious and haunting way, which is what I heard in his piano quartet. Mm. So it's really, this is his language, and I've listened to more of his music now, and that's what's there. So it's this, there's this... mix of three things. He's definitely an intellectual that he can write a fugue like that, and he can play all the Beethoven sonatas in one day. He has this intellectual side, but he also has this deep emotional side that he's not like a demonstrative person when he plays, but it's there very, very deep. So that's coming out of the music. And he's a performer, so he knows what, you know, gets out there and grabs the listener. And I hear that in all his music. So the rhythmic kind of...
So there's some driving rhythms in this piece?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. And like it's, I was listening to bits of his music, and there's things that you just can't help like tapping or you know, doing
start
this.
Rocking
like,
out to you a bit.
Any audience
head
member
bopping.
Would start doing this. You can't help it. So yeah, it's really inspiring to And interesting as I get deeper and deeper into the piece, what he's done with the orchestra, because a big thing with cello concertos is like you can't hear the cello. The orchestra's so loud. So, I mean, we haven't
we'll
played
try to
it yet,
quiet.
But no. The way he's written it is so, so clever that he's really, you know, you hear the cello with more sparse kind of, like just the percussion. Or with winds really high, or I'm playing ridiculously high up on the instrument, so it just kind of... cuts through. But yeah, I'm really excited to see how it turns out.
I'm really excited hearing you talk about it. I can't wait to learn this now.
Yeah.
I'm hoping there's woodwinds part in it, right?
Yeah.
Good. Okay. sometimes there's just strings.
There is.
Yeah.
There is.
I'm sure there's plenty more, but you must have other concerts lined up outside of here with all these different projects going on. What else can we look forward to in the near future of this season?
The one other main thing I'm focusing on now is I have a chamber music series in Hamilton, just outside of Toronto, and we do 5 concerts a year, and every other year we do something called the Cello Extravaganza. This is Cello Extravaganza 5 we're going to have on March 29th. And what it is in the first half, there's kind of solos, duos, and ensembles of cellists. And in the second half, we have this mass cello choir of all ages and all levels playing together. Once we had, I think, 50 cellists in the space. And
wow.
It's such a beautiful sound. Like, as a cellist, we do this. We play together. We love playing
cello
together.
Cello choirs are a thing, huh?
Yeah, they're a thing.
I remember my first year at Banff, and there's like this giant cello ensemble. Like,
oh, yeah.
Little kid from Newfoundland. I was like 15, I think. I was like, what is going on here?
We love it. But yeah, every other year we do that. And this year it's a benefit for Blooms for Africa and the Hamilton Youth Philharmonic Orchestra. Okay. So there's going to be a scholarship for them.
Oh, great. Lovely. Wow. You're really busy and doing a lot of things. It's amazing.
Well, I love everything that
That's
I get
great.
To do. I'm very lucky.
Well, we love that you're in this orchestra.
I feel so lucky to be working with all of you. It's an incredible, warm orchestra. I mean, everyone always says that. Everyone's so nice. But also just the standard and the level that everyone brings to everything is really inspiring. I find that every single day.
I feel the same. It's happy here. Well, thanks for doing this.
Oh, thank you so much.
And before we sign off, could you please help our listeners know where they can find your album, on what label, where they can locate that?
The latest album came out on Center Discs, which is the label of the Canadian Music Centre. So you can find the physical album through there and the digital albums available worldwide on iTunes, Amazon, Spotify, all those
Perfect.
Places.
Thank you. Go have a listen. Thanks for doing this.
Thank you.
And as we sign off on this NACOcast, we're going to hear one last excerpt from your album. Could you please tell us what it is?
What you're going to hear is the very end of Stuart Goodyear's Piano Quartet.
Thanks, Rachel.